Zephaniah 3:17 says, "For the Lord your God is living among you. He is a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears, and he will rejoice over you with joyful songs." You've just been sung over by God. He is good. Amen. Father, I would like to also thank you, just like Jessica did, for really the amazing invitation that you extend from heaven down to a broken people. None of us can really boast about anything spectacular that would earn us your love or affection or acceptance. It is simply your love being extended down to us that we should rejoice in. When all other religions of the world tell their people all that they must do to seek your affection, we can rejoice knowing that it is not us that must move toward you, but it is you who moved so graciously toward us. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you for that. And Lord, I do pray that you would use this extremely limited messenger to bring a powerful message from you, from your heart. And Lord, I do want to lift up all my brothers in Christ who will do the same tomorrow morning in our churches locally. And we pray that your Holy Spirit would fill them and that their words would have the Spirit's power in them as they send it forth to your people, that your kingdom would grow and your name would be lifted up on high. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your word, which is precious, true, perfect, and timeless. And we, all of us now who would agree, hopefully it's all of us, Lord, but we, all of us that would agree, we now willingly open up our heart and our mind, and we position ourselves now spiritually and emotionally and mentally and intellectually. We subject ourselves to the authority of your word. We crave your word, Lord. It is a delight and a joy to our heart, and we thank you for it. And so for all of those that would agree that they are willing to sit under the authority of God's perfect words, they would say amen now. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you, Lord. Awesome. Everybody doing well? Yeah? It's good to see everybody. And don't forget, you got to press record. All right, just, you know, it's been, you know, it's not a stretch to say that it wasn't going to get done. It's, huh? You're free. Can I, Ben, would you mind if I just kind of move this over here a little bit? Thank you, sir. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I tend to wander around a little bit, and I don't want to trip and fall and give Jared anything that he could use. Good to see everyone. So, everyone have a copy of God's Word? Everyone? Everyone has one? You got one on your phone. Here you go, brother. I know you want that. There you go. Now you got two. Awesome. Anyone not have a copy of God's Word? Because if you don't, there's plenty of them all over. There's blue ones all over the seats. And if you need one, just grab one. Now, not every verse will be up on the screen, but some of them. And you can read along. And if you're going to sit under the authority of God's Word, you ought to know what it is, right? I'm figuring. So we got Easter coming up next week. And yeah, that's a big deal, right? And I do hope that you will invite somebody to come to hear about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the ramifications of that resurrection. People need hope in this world, and they're going to find it there. They're going to find it there, and we're going to do our very best, Lord willing, to give them a clear message of hope that they can take with them, and it'll change their life. This weekend, as many of you know, it's what we would call Palm Sunday. Well, we don't do anything on Sunday here at our church. We're kind of a wacky bunch, but so you can see a little decoration here. This is the day that we remember when, before Jesus goes to that cross, he comes to Jerusalem to begin the process to save us, okay? And so we kind of celebrate that this week in advance of next week's celebration of the resurrection. So we hope that you will invite some folks with you next week. Now, what we're going to do, we started this series, I don't know, two months ago, the Healthy Body, studying these churches in the Bible, sovereignly placed by God, messed up churches. They go sideways, they drift off where they shouldn't be, and we're studying these things so that we would be able to identify if we've done the same, and then using God's Word to get us back on track, or if we have not yet drifted off like they have, we can see the signs of what they did and see how we can prevent that. So we're studying these churches in this. Now, next week, and I didn't even plan this. This is how cool God is. I got the verse, like the section of scriptures, like Moses, this is what you're going to talk about this year. And so it was in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. That's where we're going to be next week. So if you want to read ahead, you can. But so 1 Corinthians 15 is next week. And then last week, we got as far as 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And so right here in the middle of those two things, this is an amazing section of scripture from 11 through 14. These chapters, it's like they're one big chapter, and it's perfectly placed between last week and next week. And this section of scripture, if you read through these chapters right here, you're going to see that this section, these four, 11, 12, 13, 14, four chapters are all really about one thing. They're about this right here. They're all about this, the gathering of the saints. And a lot of different variety in that, but basically it's all about this gathering. And I'm not talking about normal gatherings that we might do in other settings, you know, the Moose Club, the Elks Lodge, maybe the gym, or surrounding ourselves around a team or something like that. But this section of scripture talks about the gathering of Christ followers like this, but with a purpose. There's a purpose behind why we gather. And it's not just for fun. There's a lot of byproduct to why we gather, but there's a reason why saints gather. And I'd like to share some of those things with you tonight. You know, when the family of God gathers together, and then you guys picked a really good night to be here because I can't pick on you on this next thing. There's a reason. There's two reasons why we should gather together. And one is just radical obedience, he says to, right? Some people say, well, you don't need to go to church to be a Christian. Well, let me just offer you something. There's radical obedience. There, attending church, gathering in the saints is a, let me tell you this, I'm going to take a firm line here, but I'm going to back it up with scripture. It is a non-negotiable. It is a non-negotiable. Let me share with you, not only is it radical obedience, but there's purpose behind it. Do me a favor, you've got your Bible. Open up a Bible to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Read something with you. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. Two verses, pregnant with truth, but we're going to pick this thing apart a little bit. And remember why we're doing this now. We want to be a church that does not drift. We don't want to be the church that starts off really well and then finds themselves in a ditch somewhere. So Hebrews chapter 10, it says this, and we're going to talk about purpose. Are you there? Kind of, sort of? Can't hear you. Love you. Okay, you ready? Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. And let us not neglect our meeting together as some people do. You see the part where I can't pick on you? You weren't that some people. You're here. Let's not neglect our meeting together as some people do, but encourage one another. And then there's a sense of urgency that the author puts in there intentionally, especially now that the day of his return is drawing near. So increasingly, as we go week to week to week to week, we should have a greater sense of urgency to gather together. But it's not just out of radical obedience. There's all kinds of stuff in here. Look what it says. Let us think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. So let me ask you this, saints. Before you guess, see, most people think that going to church is right here. And it is, but that's part of it. So it's something you're supposed to do when you get here. But before you get here, how are you doing on taking time to stop and think about how we could motivate one another to love and good deeds? Are you sitting at home going, you know what? Here's something that I think that our church could do to improve our community. And you know what? I think that Patrick's really good at that thing. He could help me, and I'm kind of good at this, and he's good at that, and maybe we could work together on that thing. And Kelly, you're kind of good at something, and there's a need in the community that Robert could fit. And are you thinking about that kind of stuff? See, that's part of the church experience, is not just coming in here and listening to one person talk, but it says to be thinking about ways to motivate one another to love and good deeds, to good works. So we got to be thinking about those things. And then what does it say? Now that you have those things, you're thinking about that, and you have some ideas, then it says to don't neglect meeting together. Why? So you could share that. So you could encourage one another with ways that we could love and extend good deeds to our community and to one another. See, that's what we're supposed to do with our church. We're supposed to think of ways. We're supposed to meet with one another. And then we're supposed to share these ways together. See, church doesn't start at 6 o'clock, you know? Did you guys know that? See, we got a service time on the sign that says 6 o'clock, but you know when church starts? The day you were reborn, that's when church started. And Jessica shared something with me today. She was watching a video from Bethel Church. This is the church. This is one of the churches worldwide that's known for their incredible, powerful worship music. They do, just crazy, right? And one of the lead singers, this incredibly gifted woman, said something about turning off the family stuff so she could come here and turn on the worship leader stuff. And the pastor looked at her and kind of said, I don't know if I'm exactly right, but he said, when did you turn off your worship stuff? Like, when did that happen? When are you supposed to do that? You're never supposed to turn off your worship hat. Never take that hat off to be mom, to be dad, to be employee, to be this, to be that. No, you're always worshiping. Worship starts the moment you've been reborn, and it should never, ever cease, ever. And so we're supposed to think about ways we could encourage one another to love and good deeds. And see, so not only is it radical obedience the reason why we get together, but listen, the church, you, this gathering, this is God's chosen avenue to achieve his purposes. He's chosen this to achieve his purposes, to advance his kingdom. He's done it through this, and he wants you to take this and be thinking about each other. How can we encourage one another to love and good deeds and then get together and share that with one another so we can be an impact to our world for Jesus Christ? How can we worship and love the Lord more and better? How can we love each other more and better? That's why we gather. Not just because he says we should, but there's purpose behind why we gather. Not just to say, okay, God, you said to meet, I will. But there's purpose behind why we gather. You know, there's not a whole lot of glory for the Lord with empty seats. And let me offer you another verse. I told you that gathering is non-negotiable, right? Do me a favor and look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19. Check this out, right? I had a buddy point this out to me the other day. I read it a million times, just never even saw it. Ephesians 5, 19. So the word of God is true, right? Y'all agree? Word of God is true. It's right. It's always right. Even if it doesn't feel right, it is right. So 5:19. Let's just go to 18. Don't be drunk with wine. Amen. Because that will ruin your life. Some of us can attest to that. So don't just put down the drink. Substitute it with something. Don't be drunk, filled up with the influence of wine, right? So instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Yes. Right? Yes. Singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves. So, some of the versions say speaking psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to one another. Let me ask you a question. How do you speak psalms to one another when you're alone? Yeah, right? I never saw that. I've read that a bunch of times. I never even saw that. How do you sing to each other when there's no one else there? You have to be together to do this, to pull this thing off. And there's not an option there. It says to do it. So I would just offer this again, that gathering right here, non-negotiable. It's not subject to whether you have something else to do, whether something else. Listen, don't settle for lesser things, loved ones. Don't settle for lesser things. Don't be pleased with the lesser things that will seem to satisfy your cravings. Like, this is the greatest craving right here. And God wants to be all that he is to you personally, not to other people, but to you. And he wants to advance his purposes through the church, and we do it by gathering with one another so we can encourage one another to love and good deeds. This is how he will advance his church, through the gathering of the saints. Amen? You all said you were going to sit under the authority of God's word, and I pray that you will. So we'll just kind of go through real quickly now through these sections of scripture in 1 Corinthians. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Go back there and you can see verses 17 and 18. They start talking about another thing that divides a church and messes up a church. And we want to steer clear of that stuff, right? So in chapter 11, verses 17 and 18, it starts talking about communion. Now, churches call it communion. They call it the Lord's Supper. Some will call it the Eucharist. But at the end of the day, it's all Jesus Christ saying, let's get together and move close to me. And we do it around the communion elements, the drink and the bread, the wafer, whatever you want to call it. So different people do it different ways. Some churches do it every week. Some churches do it every month. Some churches do it once a year. Some churches do it every quarter. We do it in different styles. Sometimes you walk up, pick off bread, dunk it in the wine. Some people use wine. Some people use juice. There's a variety of different ways, right? Now, when it comes right down to it, this begins to be a drift in the church because people start arguing about that. And so what he's really saying here in 11:20 is this communion thing. And he starts teaching us about how we're supposed to take communion. When you meet together, you're not really interested in the Lord's Supper. You see, so he's told us to take communion, but what happens is even though we're taking it, we got a problem. For some of you, hurry to eat your own meal without sharing with the others. As a result, some go hungry while others get drunk. See, they're getting hammered on the communion wine. Now, around here, that would be hard because we got little itty-bitty little shots. It would take a lot of that to get that done, but I don't think they did it this way back then. They had a wine glass, and they'd start drinking it back. Why do you do that? Don't you have your own homes for eating and drinking? Or do you really want to disgrace God's church and shame the poor? What am I supposed to say? Do you want me to praise you? Well, I certainly will not praise you for this. For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself on the night he was betrayed. And then he goes and he tells us how to take communion. Verse 26, for every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. So anyone who eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily, here's a drift again, Christians fighting, unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. So, no matter how we take communion, it's why we take communion and why you take communion that matters. And what we're trying to do in this series here is to try to attack these places where Christians draw lines and fight. And let me just tell you that when it comes to communion, whether you're dunking it or drinking it, whether it's wine or juice or bread or matzah or oyster crackers or whatever it is that you're using, listen, taking communion for any reason other than remembering the cross of Jesus Christ and his desire to go to the cross to pay for your sin and mine so we could be communing with him, getting closer to him. And when we get closer to him, as everyone, if this was Jesus, if everyone got closer to him, what would happen to you? You'd be getting closer to one another. And that's what happens around communion. And that's all that should matter. If you take communion without honoring Jesus Christ's sacrifice on the cross, you are guilty of sin. And that's a drift. And so we don't talk about this at length every week, but listen, when the communion elements come around, focus your mind on Jesus Christ the Lord. Not what song is playing, not what I'm saying, nothing. The communion, the Lord's Supper, is to remember Jesus Christ's sacrifice on the cross for your sin and mine to create one unified body. And that's it. That's why we take communion. And that's to be celebrated each and every week. If you want. You could take it in your house. You could take it at work. You could take it at church. You could take it anywhere you want, whenever you want. But when you do it, think about the Lord. Think about the Lord. The other thing that the church does, and they mention this here in 11, 17 through 18, this is amazing. I don't even know how this can even happen. It says, but in the following instructions, I cannot praise you, for it sounds as if more harm than good is being done when you meet together. So they're being obedient to get together and come to quote-unquote church, right? But there's more harm being done than good. What does that mean? First, I hear that there are divisions among you when you meet as a church. And to some extent, I believe it. So what is it? How can it possibly be? How can it be that we could come together, but yet there's divisions within the together? How about cliques? I mean, that's what we call it now, right? I mean, isn't it our natural propensity to when we walk into the room to kind of drift over to the people that we really know well, like my bestest buddy Beth here? We could just hang out, right? Or maybe it's my best friend Mark, or maybe it's my best. So I want there's certain people that I really, really love the most. I want to go hang out with them, right? But see, what happens is if we're all in the room and see what happens when Jimmy gets close to me now. Look at what happens. He gets a little further away from Kim, doesn't he? Right? See, so our natural tendency is to flock to the ones we know, love, who are like us, our favorite people, much to the neglect of every single other person in the building. And that happens, listen, it's not just here, it's everywhere. This is not a revolution problem. This is a body of Christ problem. There are some churches that separate the sections into different communities. That sounds kind of good, doesn't it? Except what happens to the people that are in different communities? We can't hang out? That's a bad view of the church. When we get together, there should be no divisions in the church. Just something to just kind of think about. We should always, always try to avoid such a thing. All right? We don't want to drift there. So always be thinking of other people, not just the ones you want to come and see the most. By the way, there'll be pizza here after we get done. Did someone turn off the air conditioning? Someone turned off the air conditioning, didn't they? Holy moly. Who was it? Who did it? Was it you, Triller? You're laughing the loudest. Oh my goodness, this is like what it's going to feel like in hell. I don't want to go there. All right, listen. That's chapter 11. We're talking about the church coming together, right? The gathering. Listen, chapter 12 has got a whole lot of stuff in it, but the main character of chapter 12 is the Holy Spirit. It's the third person of the Trinity. He is real. And this chapter talks about how he works in and amongst God's church through his power and the gifting that he brings to each believer. Now, if you look in chapter 12, verse 4, it starts out here. He starts talking about these different kinds of spiritual gifts. And he starts talking about different kinds of ways that we could serve in the body of Christ. And he starts talking about how God works in all of us in different ways. And so we start hearing about all these different, right? Different. This is our human perspective. We start seeing the differences in people, and that kind of divides us. But that's our perspective. But what God's perspective is this. He says, yeah, there's different kinds of gifts, but it's the same Spirit that gives out all the gifts. Yeah, there's different kinds of ways that you can serve in the body of Christ, but it's the same Lord that we serve. And this God, he's working in us in different ways. And we got to give each other grace for that, because he may be working in you in a way that he's not working in me. And I have to give you grace because we're all different. And God works in us in different ways. But he says, but it's the same God that's working in all of us. So you see, the human perspectives, we start hearing different. And what's God saying? Hey, listen, rope it in now. Yeah, you're all different gifts, different service. God's working in different ways, but look at it, it's the same God. We're in the same thing together, man. He tries to change our perspective on things. Now, verse 7 does say that we all get a gift. Isn't that awesome to show up at somebody else's party and you get a present? I thought that was kind of cool. He says a spiritual gift is given to each of us. So you, all of us, when you bend the knee to Christ, not only does this Holy Spirit come and live in you, but he gives you some type of special gift or talent or ability. And this is where we drift big time, man. Even the mention of the Holy Spirit makes people freak out. And listen, you shouldn't. You shouldn't at all. As a matter of fact, right at the beginning of chapter 12, he says, now, brothers and sisters, regarding your question about the special abilities of the Spirit, these spiritual gifts, he says, I don't want you to misunderstand this. He wants you to understand the Holy Spirit and what he does. It shouldn't be so mysterious. It shouldn't be so scary to mention the third person of the Trinity. He is God. But now when he gives these gifts, notice, and this is a big drift, that gift is not for you. Oh, in a sense, it's for you as well, but it's for everybody. Look what it says. It says, each of us is given a spiritual gift so we can help each other. The New King James says we're given a spiritual gift for the profit of all. English Standard Version says we're given a spiritual gift for the common good. All spiritual gifts in every single believer are given to help the church grow bigger and stronger. That's what the spiritual gifting is for. It's not for showing off. It's not to say, look what I can do. It's not to brag or boast. It's only to build up the body of Christ bigger and stronger. That's why he does it. It's for everybody. And these gifts can include it, but this is not an exhaustive list at all, but it can include this: words of wisdom, a word of knowledge, great faith. If you're a Christian, you all have faith. Some have this much, and some have Everest faith, right? I want that one. I'm so tired and weary and exhausted from not trusting God, and he keeps doing stuff for me, and then I get worried and freak out when things are kind of dark and rough, and then wham, he comes right back in and rescues me, and I just give up on him again. Am I alone? Come on now. Everyone in this room, we all do it. I want great faith. He says to desire the great gifts. I want that gift. He goes on, he says that there's the gift of healing, There's the gift of performing miracles. I kind of got confused. Kind of side note, that makes no sense to me. Is healing, if I go up to someone and say you're healed in Jesus' name, is that not a miracle if they get healed? But yet somehow, some way, the sovereignty of God distinguishes between healing and performing miracles. I have a take on that, but I'm not saying it's the gospel. My take is that I think some people have the gift of being healed, while others have the gift of performing miracles. That's just my take. That doesn't mean it's true. These gifts can also include the gift of prophecy, can include the gift of discerning between the Holy Spirit and other spirits. That's an interesting one. And that's why I love the Bible so much. Because, see, the Bible doesn't change, does it? It's the same book yesterday, today, and forever. It's the Word of God. The heavens and earth may melt away, but the Word of God will last forever. And I love this book because you know why? Because not everybody can discern between what the Spirit of God says and a deceptive spirit. Not everybody has that gift. So when you start hearing people say, the Lord said this, the Lord said that, be careful. Because not everybody has that gift, right? Some people get that gift. And so you need to be careful about what you hear and assume that because someone slaps on the tag of the Holy Spirit that it's from God, because it's not always. So you have to be careful. The gifts can include the gift of tongues. The gifts can include the interpretation of this tongues, leadership, helping others. But no matter what the gift is, every single one of the gifts from the Holy Spirit are there to build the church. They are there for the common good. They're there to profit all people, not just the person who has the gift. I would venture to say if that's why it's being used, it's not being used properly and might not even be a gift of the Holy Spirit. But let's talk some of these gifts, okay? And don't be afraid of it. Let God's word shine light into any confusion you might have. Let's talk about some big ones, and I don't mean the biggest, like as in the most important, but probably the most talked about and probably the most mysterious, although they shouldn't be mysterious to you in any way. Let's talk about healing first, okay? Listen, when I think of healing, I think Acts chapter 3. Like, you might have your favorite miracle in the Bible. And like, aside from Jesus Christ who rose himself from the dead, which I can't even begin to try to explain that. There's no words that I could frame to explain Jesus raising himself from the dead. But other than that, I'm thinking Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3, right? Acts chapter 3 is the story of this guy who's been, it says he's a man who's been lame since birth. Now, in the Jewish tradition, when you were 13, you got bar mitzvahed. You were a man. Now, we all know better, right? I don't know many 13-year-olds that are men. But I also know a lot of 50-year-olds that are babies. But that's a whole other issue. But there's this guy, right? So he's a man, and he's been lame since birth. Now, in the Bible, it talks about some people being paralyzed and crippled, but it also says lame. So there's got to be a distinction between them. Okay, paralyzed, we kind of know what that is, right? Can't move. Crippled, maybe move a little bit, but like deformed and really can't move the way you should. Then there's lame. You know what a lame horse is? Like, it's all right, come on down. You're the next contestant. Lame is severe limp, right? Lame is a bowed tendon, an Achilles tendon maybe like I'm a severe limp. And wouldn't that be discouraging? Where like you almost can do what everyone can do, but you just can't quite get there. Be frustrating, wouldn't it? Get you kind of down sometimes, wouldn't it? So here's the story of this guy, and listen, he doesn't have a good, it's not a good deal. He's lame since birth, and so he's got people, lame means you can kind of get along, but it's really bad. He's got people who carry this man, carry him outside of the temple. So like this is a temple, outside the door. So as you walk up, saints, let's just say there's a guy sitting on the steps, right? He's not coming in. This will preach too. Some people don't want to come in. He won't come in. Hold on. He won't come in and give anything to God, but he'll stand on that step and receive from God. He'll beg. That's what the story is. He'll beg on the steps. Can I have some money? He'll look to the people of God. Can I have some money? Can I have some money? Things aren't good. And some people are like that. We want to get stuff from God, but we won't give anything to God. Okay? And maybe, I hope that's not you, but that's true. We all probably know some folks like that. I pray it's not you. But this guy's outside the temple, and he's begging for money. Life's not that good. And here comes Peter and John. They walk up on him, and he begs, hey guys, can I have some money? And so they look at him, and they're like, well, silver and gold I don't have, but I will give you what I do have. In the name of Jesus Christ, stand up and walk. And boom, he stands up, completely healed. And he goes walking around, and then read the story. He's leaping and praising. And guess what? He finally walked in the door. There's something, listen, talk about healing. I want that. Who would like to do that? Come on now, right? Let's be honest. Who would like to be able to stand up, look at someone who's, in the name of Jesus, stand up and walk to a, who would want to go to Waterman Hospital with me tonight and save some babies? Come on, right? I mean, honestly, I want that. I want, and that's a holistic healing. Look at, this person couldn't really walk. Now he's walking, physically healed. Then he's leaping. How much leaping was he doing before? And it wasn't just because he was lame. It's because he had settled into despair, didn't he? At least 13 years of being unable to walk like normal people. That'll bum you out. And now he's leaping, leaping for joy and praising God. There's a spiritual healing. He's praising God now, and then he went into the church. So you can see there's kind of a spiritual healing there as well. There's a full healing in this guy. And I want that. I want that so well. Awesome that would be. Now, when you hear that story, some Christians of a more charismatic flavor, they'll go Mark 16:17, right there. Boom, Mark 16:17. You can go there if you want. Mark 16:17 says this, that these signs and wonders will follow or accompany those who believe. They'll cast out demons. They'll speak in tongues. They'll lay their hands to the sick and they'll be healed. Amen, right? Awesome. See, verse 18 is they'll put their hands to the sick and they'll be healed. And we want that. And some people will say, we can do that. It says it. Listen, that's the second part of that verse. Verse 18, first, before it says they'll lay hands to the sick and be healed, it says that they'll handle snakes and not be hurt, and they'll drink poison, and they will not be harmed. How's that going for you? I mean, if we're gonna lay hands, you can't pick and choose Bible verses, bro. Right? If it says it, we're all going to be able to lay our hands to sick and they're going to be healed. Well, all of you can pick up snakes and get bitten and it's not going to cause a problem and you can start drinking Drano, no issues. Yeah, that's not recommended, by the way, for the record. Scotty was like, no. No, Scotty. He's like, that is so cool, man. So here's the, listen, this is a drift. So the position is, I'm a believer, so I can do that too. Now, without voicing your opinion on whether you can lay your hands to the sick and they'll be healed, and whether you're going to cast out demons and speak in tongues and hold snakes and drink poison, listen, before, I don't want to know what your position is on whether you believe that all believers can do these things or all cannot or whatever. Let me just ask you, just with a show of hands, without voicing your opinion, with a show of hands, who has an opinion on this? You can raise your hand. Even no one's going to know what it is. Okay? There's a drift right there. This is what happens. None of those things, no matter what your position is on this, neither position defines who you are. And neither of those positions, not only should they not define who you are as an individual, but they should never identify who you are as a church family. You know what identifies you? You're a blood-bought child of Almighty God through Christ Jesus. And that's it. You're a co-heir with Christ. You're a son or a daughter of God because of Jesus Christ. You know what identifies you? If anyone's in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has died. Behold, the new man. That's what identifies you. And those things don't identify who you are or who your church is, but oftentimes that's what identifies a church. It happens all the time. And it shouldn't. It shouldn't. Now, if healings didn't freak you out, let's talk tongues. My Pentecostal friends are like, yeah, finally, woo-hoo! The Baptists are leaving. What did I think? No. Listen, he doesn't want us to be confused about these things. It's nothing that should drive everyone crazy. It's just as clear as the other stuff in the Bible. It's not to be confused. Acts chapter 2, let's talk tongues, right? Acts chapter 2, Pentecost. So here's this holiday, right? And they're going to celebrate this holiday in Jerusalem. So they got Jews from all over the area. So if you could picture kind of Israel, right? And people from all over the known world around there, what they do is they would travel to Jerusalem and they would worship God and celebrate Pentecost together. Kind of like, I'm not saying that you should or shouldn't, but like I think it's Muslims, they'd have this, they got to go to Mecca kind of thing. Well, this is kind of what was going on in Jerusalem. You went to Jerusalem to celebrate Pentecost. So there's people coming from all different places to Jerusalem to celebrate, right? And so when they get there, all of a sudden, the disciples, Jesus had just ascended and the church had just started and they're meeting in this room and all of a sudden, the people from all around, they gather around these people and these people who lived right there started preaching the gospel, the good news of Jesus' salvation for your sin, right, to all these people in their language. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know French and Spanish and German. I don't know that stuff, right? But if a German dude came in there, all of a sudden I'd start preaching the good news of Jesus in German, fluent German. That would freak me out, right? But that's exactly what's happening in Acts chapter 2. People are coming all over, and these people that don't know their language are fluently speaking the language of those people so that they would know the gospel. See, Jesus said in Acts 1:8 that you will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. How's a little group of people going to get that done? This is how. He starts, the gospel is locked and loaded into these people from all around so they can have the good news of Jesus and then go back to their place to start preaching the good news to their community. That's how it's going to get done. That's how you're going to be my witnesses to the ends of the earth. Now, you guys all can agree whether that really happened or not, but it's in the Bible. But here's where it gets a little bit sticky for some, right? So would you guys kind of agree that at Pentecost, that's kind of what happened? Start speaking in other people's languages so they could hear the gospel? Anyone disagree with that? Okay, you do? You agree? Okay. Well, here's what happens. This is where people start going crazy, and they shouldn't. Chapter 13, if I could speak all the languages of the earth, kind of like what was happening there at Pentecost, right? But then look what he says, everyone, and the languages of angels. Ooh. Everyone's like, freaking out. What is that? Okay. Languages of the angels. What is that? 1 Corinthians 14:14. For if I pray, not preach, right? So they were preaching at Pentecost the gospel to other people, but in 14:14 it says, if I pray, what's that? Right here, right? Right? If I pray
not preach, but pray in tongues. My spirit is praying, but I don't even understand what I'm saying. How about 14 verses 15 through 17? Check that out. Well then, what shall I do? I will pray in the spirit, and I will also pray in words I understand. I will sing in the spirit, and I will also sing in words I don't understand. For if you praise God only in the spirit, like words that you don't understand, how can those who don't understand you praise God along with you? How can they join you in giving thanks when they don't understand what you are saying? Now, you're speaking in something no one understands, but it says here in verse 17, you'll be giving thanks very well. So you're speaking in this language, you don't even know what it is. And God's like, I totally approve of this. I love that worship. That's what it says, right? And it's kind of freaking out for people. Now let me ask you a question. Chapter 14, verse 28, what about that? The speaking in tongues, well, what if there's no one there to interpret? Well, if there's no one there to you can present as an interpreter, then the person speaking tongues must be silent in your church meeting and speak in tongues to God privately. Okay, listen. You can believe what you want. I'm not going to tell you what you have to believe. You got to read the scriptures and figure this out for yourself. But why would someone have to sit there and talk privately to God in another known, like, for instance, I'm just going to use an example. Why would I sit here, an English-speaking man, who God can completely understand what I'm thinking and saying? Would you agree? Why would I sit here and speak privately to God in French? Making a whole lot of sense, does it? I would tell you that there's another language. I would tell you that there's a spiritual language that I cannot decipher for you. I can't explain it to you. But there's something in the scriptures that tells us that there's some type of unknown language that is spoken to God that pleases him that you don't even understand what it is. Right? But listen, let me ask you a question. This is where we drift. This is where churches divide and fight. Battle lines are drawn and division ensues. Does it clearly tell you whether these unknown languages are unknown to the ends of the earth or unknown to the people that were there? Does it say? No, it doesn't. We cannot divide on this. Have your opinion. But it doesn't clearly state, when it says unknown languages, it doesn't say if it's unknown languages to all of humanity or unknown languages to those that are present. It does not say. Now, without telling me your position, who has an opinion, show of hands, on tongues? Position, right? Let me reiterate that whatever position you take, it does not identify who you are. And it can never identify who the church is. Ever. Ever. Would it be angelic? Would it be German? Would it be French? Would it be Spanish? That's angelic, right? Are these gifts still in operation today, or like a continuationist? Is that who you are? Or do you think that the spiritual gift of tongues and prophecy and healing, that they died with the original apostles, and so you're a cessationist? People have opinions, don't they? Listen, without voicing your opinion, who believes either they died with the apostles or these gifts go on? Don't say what your opinion is, but do you have an opinion? Yeah, of course. 1 Corinthians 13:10 says that prophecy, tongues, and the gift of special knowledge will end, you ready for this? When the time of perfection comes. Here's another drift. Here's another division. Some people think that we have a much better prophecy now because the perfect word of God has been canonized. 66 books of the Bible, it is God's inspired word, and it is perfect, and it is true, and it is timeless, and this is our perfect word. And so that's what it means, because a lot of people think that. I don't think that. I only know of one thing that's ever been perfect since the dawn of creation, and his name is Jesus. And so I believe that these gifts continue until the time of perfection, and that time has a name, and his name's Jesus. When he returns, those things will end. We don't need to speak in tongues when we're all in heaven with Jesus, right? Don't need to do much prophesying or healing up there, right? No more tears, no more pain, no more sorrow. Everything's good. I make all things new. You don't need to heal anybody in heaven, do you? So that's what I think. You a spirit-filled church? Do you operate in all the gifts? I don't even know. But battle lines are drawn, division ensues, the church begins to drift because we identify with these things. These are the things that we identify ourselves with instead of saying, I'm just a Christian. And you believe that and you believe that, but we're Christ followers. You know, in the book of Colossians, Paul says it doesn't matter in this new life who gave their life to Christ. Raise your hand loud and proud, right? It's awesome. Right? You know what? In this new life, in this new family, it doesn't matter if we're Jew or Gentile, slave or free, civilized, uncivilized, barbaric. It doesn't make any difference who we are. That's all that matters is that Christ is in us all. That's it. It doesn't matter what you believe about the gifts. The gifts didn't drive Jesus to the cross to save us. The gifts didn't save you at all. The gifts are secondary in importance. And listen carefully now. You ready? If all spiritual gifts are given to the body of believers by the one Holy Spirit to build up and strengthen the entire body of Christ, then these gifts and our opinion on them should never, ever be the catalyst to divide a church. Ever. Someone give me a real amen on that one. Absolutely. Listen, if these spiritual gifts cause strife and division in the church, this is not the work of the Holy Spirit of God. Ever. Ever, ever, ever. You can have your position, you can have your gift, but if the exercise or the view of that gift causes his bride to split, it is not the work of the Holy Spirit of God. Listen, Paul tells us that through Christ's death on the cross, that Jesus Christ, he broke down the walls of hostility between people. And these are never walls to be rebuilt. Never, ever to be rebuilt again. It wasn't the gifts that put Jesus Christ on the cross. It wasn't his gifts of healing and prophecy and tongues that saved you. Do you know what put Jesus on the cross? Love. Love put Jesus on the cross. Because he loves us, he put himself on the cross to save you. That's what put Jesus on the cross. And I would offer this to you. If the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever, then the chief end of the church is to love. To love. Do me a favor, I'm just about done. Look at chapter 14. Right in the middle of all this stuff about the spiritual gifts of all these different kinds that everyone seems to bicker over and argue over and start new churches over and divide over and strife and fight. Right in the middle of this all, look at verse 14:1. What's it say? Can someone just loud and proud, who could tell me what 14:1 says?
Let love be your highest goal.
Boom. That's it. That's the chief end of the church, is to love. God's great commandment. Someone asked Jesus, what's the most important thing of all? What does he say? Love the Lord God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and love people. That's what we're supposed to do. The church is supposed to love. That's it. That's what we're supposed to do. The gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel of love, is Jesus declaring to us, I will move close to you and I will not abandon you, even though you are often wrong. But we won't do that. How many people think that they're right and Jesus is wrong about anything? But what does he say? I will never leave you. I will never forsake you, even though you're wrong about all kinds of stuff. Even though you're naughty so often, even though you're an active, willful rebellion against me, I will not leave you. Shouldn't the church do the same? Come on now, right? Listen, he didn't say, all authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Now go make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And remember this, I'll be with you to the end of the age, as long as you speak in tongues. And he didn't say, and I will be with you as long as you're a cessationist and believe that the gifting has ended since the Bible was made. Like, there's no star there. There's no asterisk. It says, I will not leave you. I'm with you. You're part of my family. I died on the cross to put you in my family, and nothing's going to change that. It was love that brought us together as a family, and I will say that love is the glue that keeps Christ's family together when we differ. 1 Corinthians 13:5 says, love does not demand its own way. Amen. Come on, right? And isn't that what we do? Everyone thinks that their Christianity is the Christianity, and you got to do it my way. If you don't do it my way, it's thy way. But love doesn't demand its own way, right? Doesn't. So if you had your hand up because you believe that all believers should be able to lay their hands to the sick and heal them, if you had your hand up for that, and there's other people in the room that didn't have their hand up for that because you don't believe it, can't we just all love each other anyway? Isn't it okay? I kind of think it's okay, right? Some of us, half the room probably thinks that everybody could go around healing everybody. And some people don't. Did that belief save you? Did that belief put you into the body of Christ? Did that belief put you into the Revolution Church? None of it. None of the above. What put you into the body of Christ? Jesus on the cross and him crucified. That's it. Differing is okay, but division is not okay. Here's the last verse I want to read to you. It's in Ephesians chapter 4. Then we'll eat pizza. Good. Amen? Free. Boom. That was a good one. I can tell you what, it's probably not going to be kosher. It better have some swine on it. Sorry, Frank. I love you. Listen, Ephesians 4. Here, let me read something to you. Ready? Am I in the right place? Ephesians 4, 1 through 6. Oh, yeah. Here we go. You ready? Here's Paul, right? He's in jail. He says, I beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. So point to who he's talking to. All of you have been called by God, right? All of you have been called to repentance and faith. You've been called into the family of God, right? And so he's saying, because of this amazing gift that you got, I'm begging you to live a life worthy of that. And he's going to explain what that means. And in this context, what we're talking about tonight, this is so awesome. Look what he says. He says, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Not division, not splitting up, not saying you have to do what I do. You have to believe what I believe. No, that's not what Christians do. Remember what Jesus does when you're wrong and naughty and rebellious? He sticks with you. He's a friend that sticks closer than a brother, the Bible says. Be patient with each other. Man, we need some of that. Making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. Now look at this. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit. Do you see what the Spirit of God is really doing? He's using love to keep us together. But humans, as sinful people who just can't just seem to do anything right, we drive each other apart because of our preferences and our opinion. And he's like, no, look, make every effort to keep yourself united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. Now look at this, right? Remember earlier I said that there's all these different gifts and all different types of service, that, like the way you perform your duties, if you will, in the body of Christ, and God's working on you. Like you may have gotten this far in your faith, and some people only this far, and he's working on each and every one of us. The one who began a good work will continue to do so until the day of Christ Jesus. But look what he says, even though there's all these differences, there is one body and one Spirit. Just as you have been called to one glorious hope for the future, there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father who is over all, in all, and living through all. There's one God, and there's one body, and there's one faith. And these other things that we try to identify ourselves by, these giftings and our perception and our opinion and position on the things of the Holy Spirit that cause us to divide, that needs to go away. Love put Jesus on the cross and created a family. And love will keep the family together when we differ in opinion. It's the Holy Spirit's job. Listen again. It's the Holy Spirit's job to bring us together. Anything that has the tag of the Holy Spirit on it that would cause believers to have strife and divide is not the work of the Holy Spirit. His job is to, with love, bring us together. Do you see this? The Spirit unites us because of love. And I would venture to say that it definitely is love that will keep the church together. The identity of a real church isn't wrapped up in its spiritual gifts. Our identity is in Christ, and in Christ alone. The Bible says that they will know us by the way we love one another. So I commend to you this. Let's make love the highest goal of Revolution Church. It's in our name. We got to live up to it. Let's pray. And then we're going to take communion together. If I could get a couple guys to come hand this out and we'll get done praying, then we're going to take communion together as a family. And I want to just do this while your heads are down and you got your eyes closed. I want to remind you about what the scriptures say about communion. It is only to celebrate what Jesus Christ did on the cross to forgive us of our sins, to create a family. And when we come together around what Jesus Christ did and who he is, we draw closer to one another. And that's what we do in communion. So Lord, I want to thank you for this word tonight. I thank you for the amazing clarity of God's word. I thank you, Lord, that you don't want these things of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, the third person of the Trinity, the one who loves us and inspires us to do great things and leads us into all truth and convicts us of sin and enlightens the Word of God to us. You inspired the writers of Scripture to write the Word, Holy Spirit. You're an amazing God. And Lord, we don't want you to cause us to divide. We don't want to drift off like that. We want to be a church that stays centered. And you said that we should fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. And it is in him that we find our identity. And we thank you for that, Lord. Help us to always be a church that stays focused on you. Not necessarily what you do or what you give or what you take away, but who you are and who we are in you. Keep us there, Lord. Now, Lord, as we take communion, we get ready to take communion, Lord, I pray that you would work in each and every one of us now to draw close to you.
Now, family of God, as these men bring the elements to you, I'm going to encourage you to, while they're playing music up here, to take this communion whenever you and the Lord are ready to take this communion. Don't wait for me to come up. This is between you and Him now. Enjoy this time with your Lord.